and I'm going to get on about my business. And Reverend Corbett's not here, but I'm going to follow his directions. He said, son, get up, speak up, and shut up. I'm going to try my best to get you back to your homes this afternoon in time that you can unthaw it if you haven't already. And get things ready for celebration of the greatest day there is. The day that God sent his son to us as a present. Amen?
Amen.
Let's get right to it, okay? Our scripture today is going to come from a familiar scripture. Let me give you some other confirmation that the word that's coming to you was supposed to come to you this day. You see what's on your program?
All right.
I didn't ask whoever wrote these programs to put it on here. But you'll see, we're going to turn to Isaiah chapter 9.
Yes, sir.
Old Testament scripture, and we're going to consider verses 1 through 7. Isaiah chapter 9, the Prince of Peace will be born. Nevertheless, the dimness shall not be such as was in her vexation. When at the first he lightly afflicted the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterwards did more grievously afflict her by the way of the sea beyond Jordan in Galilee of the nations. The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them hath the light shined. Thou hast multiplied the nation and not increased her joy. The joy before thee according to the joy of the harvest, and as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For thou hast broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. For every battle of the warrior is with confused noise, and garments rolled in blood, that this may be burning in fuel of fire. Our verse of emphasis and for consideration more deeply today begins in verse number 6.
All right.
For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. It's called eternity. Amen. Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment, with justice from henceforth, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this.
Yes, sir.
May the Lord add a blessing to those who hear, for those who read, more importantly, for those who obey his word. The title for the message today is called The Promise and the Presence of God. Not to be confused with the P-R-E-N-S-E-N-T-S presence that we so mostly associate with Christians, but the P-R-E-S-E-N-C-E, the presence of God. Amen?
Amen.
And if I had to subtitle it, it might be the gift that keeps on giving. That was confirmed by Deacon Murray. That was the last words he said before he left the boat. The gift that keeps on giving. The gift of the for this message. Amen?
Amen?
Let me tell you a story. Let me tell you a story about a man who was wise in his own eyes. When we get that way sometimes, we need to be careful. The Bible says that a day in the life of God like 1,000 years, right?
Yes, sir.
And he also says that 1,000 years is but a day in God's eyes. Well, in the wisdom of our eyes, there was one who thought he would challenge the wisdom of God. So he approached God and he says, God, I heard you say that a day in your life is like 1,000 years in our life. 1,000 years is but a day. And God said, yes, You heard rightfully so. He said, well, if I could do some math on this thing, that means that $1 million to you is but a penny to us. God didn't answer him. He just kind of looked at him. He said, go on. And so the man said, well, let me reason with you for a bit. God, I just need $1 million, because it ain't but a penny to you. So God thought about that thing. And in his wisdom, he said, sure, I'll give you $1 million, but you're going to have to wait a couple minutes. Some of y'all ain't bad. But y'all like it. It might be a longer sermon than I thought. Praise the Lord. We get wise in our own lives, but let us not get wise before the Almighty God. Amen? What is Christmas, by the way? Christmas is God's intervention into a world that's gone amok. Amen. Said last week that if you are drowning, you need a lifeguard. Amen. If you got pain, you need a doctor to write your prescription. But if you dead, you got a God-sized problem, and you need a God-sized intervention. Yeah. The Bible says that we were dead in our trespasses and sin, and that God sent us a gift in the person of his son, Jesus Christ. So it's quite appropriate that as we celebrate Christmas, that we should celebrate the deliverance from oppressive times in the form of a baby. A baby in a manger. Have mercy, y'all. And the Bible says that God sent him in the fullness of time. Why then at that time and not this time? Well, this time is our time. I'm going to see if I can give you a picture of what Jesus being born at this time might look like, and you better understand why God sent him in the fullness of his time. Amen? All right, Jesus was born, and aren't you glad? Think about this. Jesus is born in a stable with animals, the smell of urine and the smell of manure. Police arrived. You know why they arrived? Because Mary and Joseph about to be arrested. They about to be arrested for child endangerment. And DSS about to be caught. Amen. Think about this. The reason they were in Bethlehem to begin with was because somebody up there signed a new tax agreement.
And he's still practicing medicine today without a license.
Same Jesus who never wrote a song. But more songs are sung about him than any other person ever lived. That's Jesus. It's the same Jesus who never wrote a book. Bestseller. Greatest book ever written. Ministering to us today. Oh, I'm talking about Jesus, y'all. He never traveled more than 300 miles in his lifetime. But his name is called on every place on this earth today. That's Jesus, y'all. And the same Jesus, Lord, you will say, ladies, to never own the home. But he is the same Jesus that goes and prepare a place for us. That where he is, we may be also. Amen? Amen. So this is all about Jesus. But let's go back to the title, the gift that was promised. God has promised us many gifts. He's promised us peace. He's promised us joy. But the one that I want to bring to your attention today is the one that we see evidence in God himself. We see an evidence in Jesus, the Son of God. And we see an evidence in the Holy Spirit of God. And this is the gift that I want you to unwrap under your Christmas tree that lies in your heart. This is the gift that you ought not to leave here just taking the paper off. Okay, you need to open the box and get down to all the trimmings and get to the heart of this gift. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Back in the Garden of Eden, the Bible tells us that in the coolness of the day, that God walked with Adam and Eve. You with me? God walked with Adam and Eve. As we travel on into time in the Old Testament, we hear David write the 23rd Psalm. And he said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, because God is with me.
Yeah.
All right. You get it? Amen?
Amen?
And as we go on, we hear that James, the brother of Jesus in the New Testament, says that every good gift and every perfect gift is coming from God above and is coming down from the Father of lights. And Ephesians reminds us that for grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not of your own. It is the gift of God. You ain't heard me yet. Here's what I'm trying to say to you, Rehoboth, today. That the one gift that you need to be aware of that God has given you that's under the Christmas tree in your heart is the gift of his presence.
Yes.
That God is with you. God so loved the world that he gave a gift. He gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but there's another gift, that you shall have eternal life. But you can't have eternal life unless the gift of God being with you is present.
Amen.
It must be the presence of God. In fact, our text for today takes us at the end of several promises that God made to us. And he gave us a sign that this gift was coming. And this is in the context for chapter 9 and the scripture that we're going to consider. In Isaiah chapter 7:16, God announces this promised gift. Listen to what God said. He said, therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel. What does it mean? God be with us. Oh, that's the gift. You ought to be happy that God is going to be with you. He didn't promise you you wouldn't go through some stuff. Oh, that ain't what he promised you. He said, I'll be with you every step of the way. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. You can always count on God being with you every step of the way. And that's the presence of God. That's the promise of God. The promise of his presence. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, the context for very broad. And I'm going to take the time, because I am trying to be sensitive to your time. It is Christmas Eve. But let us not forget the gift.
Amen?
In chapter 7, the context of chapter 9 is found in chapter 7 through chapter 8. In chapter 7, verses 1 through 14, God talks about a blessing. He really puts Judah and Samaria and Assyria on this high plane. And he says that, I promise you that I'm going to give you this sign that a child should be born. But then after verses 1 through 14, chapter 7, he goes down to the valley and he talks about judgment. And he talks about judgment from 7:16 up through 8:22. And that's where we find ourselves when we come into our text for the day in chapter 9. Israel had a king. He was an awful king. He was King Ahaz. His grandfather and his father were good kings for Israel, but Ahaz was not so. So they had been under the oppression of Ahaz. They'd been under the attack of several different enemies during that time. But this chapter opens with the word of hope. If you have your Bible, still turn to the scripture. Look at verse 1. And I won't read it to you. I'm sure you can reference it. In verse 1, Isaiah brings hope to those who are distressed. He says they'll experience comfort. He says the land of Zebulun and Naphtali, which is the northern region of Galilee, will be the first place that Jesus would come. And if you know the story of Jesus, Jesus was born in Nazareth, and when Jesus got ready to preach the gospel in Nazareth, they ran him out. They sure did. They sought to push him off a cliff. Jesus made his way to Capernaum, and that's where Jesus, which is in the Galilee area, that's where Jesus set up shop. So his headquarters was in Capernaum. Verse 2 tells us that Isaiah uses light and darkness to associate judgment and salvation. Darkness being judgment, light being salvation. How many of you know that light and darkness cannot coexist? Let me ask you again. How many of you know that light and darkness cannot coexist? You ever been in the cave? Who went to visit the cave in Tennessee? And you could not see your hand in front of your face because of the intense and immense darkness. But you can flash a light, and all of a sudden, you can see very well. Such was the situation in this area. It was darkness. These people were practicing paganism. But the light that they had seen was the light that God had promised them in 7:14 in Isaiah. And it was a great light. Jesus said to them, I am the light of this world. If you need other evidence, you need only to look to Revelation chapter 22, verses 23 and 24, where it tells us there's going to be a new Jerusalem. And when that new Jerusalem comes, it says there'll be no sun, and there'll be no moon, because there'll be no need, because the glory of God will shine so bright that there won't be a need for the sun and the moon. Again, that's because God will be with us in the New Jerusalem. Amen. Have mercy, y'all. Have mercy, y'all. Help me out. But our verse of emphasis comes from verses 6 to 7. And y'all let me, I'm going to take 5 minutes there. So. And then we're going to get on to the close. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Verse 6 says, and 7 says, unto us a child is born. And this speaks of the humanity of Christ. He came from a woman's womb. He was just like you and I in all points tested. He was human. We don't have a Savior that does not know our infirmities. He knows exactly what we're going through down here. Because he was born of a woman. The Bible says man born of a woman is sure. And if you look at the life of Jesus, it bears witness that his life was also short and full of troubles. His earthly life, let me put that there because his eternal life goes a lot farther. We'll talk about that in a minute. Unto us a son is given. That speaks to the eternity and the divinity of Christ. A son is given. You can't give what you ain't got. All right? So God had Jesus with him from the beginning of eternity's past, from the beginning of time, from the Alpha. And he's going to have it to the Omega. So this speaks to who Christ is. He is all flesh, all human, but he is also all God. A son is born and a son is given. But this is where we get to the good stuff. The Bible says that he should have some titles. His first title should be Wonderful Counselor. Right. Now, you need to back up and make sure you get that word wonderful. Because that ain't like the wonderful we use. It ain't that kind of wonderful. It's not that kind of wonderful. The kind of wonderful that we're talking about here is the supernatural wonderful. The kind of wonderful of counsel, not the counsel that you go to and pay your money, and then he tells you when you can come, and then you talk to him, and you tell him stuff that you already know. It's not that kind of counsel. This is the kind of counsel that you go to, and he already knows what you're thinking before you get there. He already has a divine solution right here in this book for you if you just accept the gift of God being with you. That's the kind of counselor Jesus is. It's the spirit of counsel that we're talking about when we say wonderful, supernatural counselor that knows the beginning and the end and everything in between. He's a wonderful counselor, y'all. Will you accept him as your gift? Will you trust him is the question. Will you trust him? Then he's called a mighty God. Did anybody ever show up at your doorstep and they start talking about Jesus was a prophet, but he wasn't the Son of God?
Right.
I want you to take him to Isaiah chapter 9, verse 26, verse 6 and 7. In essence, to read that, it says that he was a son that's given, a son that's born, and he's a mighty God. Okay, so you can have that conversation with those folks, and I'm not going to call in them. But if they come to your house and they say, Jesus ain't the Son of God, then you need to open your Bible and go to chapter 9, verses 6 through 7. Okay. Amen?
Right.
This says that Jesus is omnipotent.
All
right. Omni means all. Holy means power. He's a mighty God. He's all power. And he's all power. You can trust Christ. He's the everlasting Father. That means he's been from times past to times future. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He is God. He was with God. John said in the beginning, he was with God, and nothing that was made wasn't created by him. He's the everlasting Father. Now we're getting into the future. For a time that has not yet come, when we say the Prince of Peace. Right now, we have another leader, and I'm going to tell you again if I hadn't told you already, so God can use unrighteous people to achieve his purpose.
Right.
Yeah, he sure can. He used Herod. He used Pilate. He can use anybody. Even if they named Star with T, he can use them too, all right? The Prince of Peace, and there will be no peace in Jerusalem. There will be no peace in Jerusalem. I promise you, by the authority of the Word of God, there will be no peace in Jerusalem until Jesus comes. Amen? Amen. You can pull Jerusalem from the capital of Palestine and Jerusalem to the capital of Jerusalem if you want and say, I'm doing it in the name of peace, but there will be no peace. There will be no peace until Jesus comes. Bible says so. And this Prince of Peace is talking about a time that is not yet come. So as we go through these names, the Wonderful Counselor, that's right now. That's his presence. He's in your heart. The Mighty God, that's right now. A right now in time God. The Everlasting Father, that's a hope of eternity. And the Prince of Peace is also a hope of eternity. Let me tell you what God promised us, and then I'll get on our way. God promised us in the name of Emmanuel that I will be with you. Amen? Jesus said he was one with the Father. But then, Jesus gave that promise also when he left his disciples. You remember Matthew 28, 20, what Jesus said? Listen to what Jesus said in those verses. Go ye therefore to all nations, making disciples, spread the gospel, advance the kingdom. I paraphrase. But he said, lastly, that lo, I am with you even till the end of the earth. That's the gift. That's the promise that Jesus gave to us, that he will be with us even to the end of the earth. And then it goes even farther. He said, I'm not going to leave you lonely. I'm going to send you the comforter of the Holy Spirit. If you know Christ and you know that inside your heart, Christ is there in the form of the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit, God and Christ are one. God is with you. Amen? Oh, man, that's what he promised us. And now, the gift that keeps on giving, Brother Marcus, that's your charge. And that's my job. Our job is to accept the gift that he gave. We accept the gift that he gave. The gift is not for us. The gift is for us to give to someone else. And as you continue to give the gift of God to somebody else, and they receive it, and they keep giving the gift of God to somebody else, and they receive it, what you're going to find is through one man, Jesus, he has transformed the whole. Unwrap the gift that's under the Christmas tree of your heart that Jesus has given you, if you will just trust him. If you'll just trust him. Lastly, I want to talk about that future. That future coming. Jesus has come once, and Jesus is coming again. We need to make sure we're ready to receive him. When he comes again, he came once to save you. He ain't coming back to save you. He's coming back as king. He's coming back as a judge, as a king. He's coming back. Will you be ready? Will you say yes when he comes again? But you can't say yes when he comes again. If you don't say yes now, don't be present. You got to open that room and receive him in your heart. You got to receive him and trust him in your heart, because when he comes again, it's going to be too late. Amen? Here's what the Bible says about Jesus. He says that he is the King of the Jews. He is the King of Israel. He's the King of righteousness and the King of the ages. He's the King of heaven and the King of glory. He's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. That's our King. Will you trust him?
Yes.
Will you trust him and open that record today? He had no predecessor, and he'll have no successor. He's the Alpha, and he's the Omega. There was nobody before him, and there will be nobody after him. You need only to trust him. You need to trust him, y'all. He's the leader of the legislature. He's the overseer of your never stop giving. Yeah. Yeah.